Let's look at how you would culture the cells of the worst malaria-causing parasite known to man, Plasmodium falciparum.
There are actually several laboratory strains of Plasmodium falciparum, and each one has unique characteristics that makes it suitable for specific research purposes. So the 3D7 strain, for instance, is isolated from a patient in the Gambia, and it features extensively as the reference strain in genome sequencing projects. It's sensitive to most antimalarial drugs, and therefore it makes it suitable for studies on basic biology and comparative genomics. There's the DD2 strain, which was derived from the W2 strain, which was isolated in Southeast Asia. So this strain is resistant to chloroquine and other antimalarials. It's frequently therefore used in drug resistance research. But there are more. There's the HB3 strain, NF54 strain, WT, isolated from Southeast Asia. There's the ITG, there's FCR3, there's K1, there's T9/96. And so depending on your research, you will choose the suitable strain. In this culturing, we were using 3D7 and DD2. By the way, cell lines for studying biology are made by isolating the cells from an organism, then immortalizing the cells or using it as is. If you immortalize it, it gives you a longer lifespan, as in the cells are not going to die after a while, so you can continue to use those same cells in perpetual experiments, or you can culture them as is, and this is referred to as primary cells. So the 3D7 and DD2 cell lines are immortalized, and that means they've had viral genes inserted into them to allow them to divide continuously without senescing. So these are the materials that we will need. You're going to need red blood cells from humans. They're also referred to as erythrocytes. The O blood group is often used. If you're unfamiliar with blood groupings, I've covered that topic on this channel and I'll link it in the comments. You will need culture medium. For Plasmodium culture, we need RPMI 1640. This is to be supplemented with Albumax, Heapies, glucose, hypoxanthin, and gentamicin. RPMI stands for Roswell Park Memorial Institute. It was formulated at that institute in 1966. It was originally formulated for the growth of human lymphoblastoid cells in suspension cultures, but it's since been used for other cell lines, particularly suspension cell lines and Plasmodium cultures. The Albumax is a lipid-rich bovine serum albumin, so it's BSA substitute, that is used as a serum replacement. It provides fatty acids, lipids, and proteins that are essential for Plasmodium growth and survival, especially because the parasite cannot synthesize certain lipids on its own. The Heapies acts as a buffering agent and helps to maintain a stable pH in the culture medium. It's particularly useful for maintaining the pH when cultures are removed from carbon dioxide incubators, as it provides buffering independent of bicarbonate. The glucose is used because glucose is a primary energy source for Plasmodium parasites. It supports the high metabolic demands of the parasites during their intra-erythrocytic growth stages. Hypoxanthin serves as a purine precursor for the synthesis of nucleotides. Since Plasmodium falciparum cannot synthesize purines on their own, it salvages them from the medium, and hypoxanthin is critical for DNA and RNA synthesis. Then there's gentamicin that is used as an antibiotic to prevent bacterial contamination in the culture. It inhibits bacterial protein synthesis by binding to the 30S ribosomal subunit, ensuring that the culture remains free of bacterial interference. Then you will need a parasite culture. You can obtain this from a lab next door, or from another laboratory, or from a parasite bank. Then you're gonna need a gas cylinder
a mixture of gases. So you want one that's mixed with 5% carbon dioxide, 5% oxygen, and the rest is just nitrogen. You're going to need a 37 degree incubator for the parasites and a centrifuge for prepping the blood, the whole blood, so that you retain only the red blood cells. You will need a microscope in order to be able to look at parasitemia or the parasites inside the red blood cells. Just a warning that this work should be done in a biosafety level 2 or 3 laboratory. Now we're ready to process samples. So you want to collect human blood. As mentioned, O positive is ideal, and you want to go ahead and separate the red blood cells from the buffy coat and the white blood cells. So you do this by centrifugation. So you spin it. Usually people will spin at a low speed for a longer period, such as 300 centrifugal force, or they may use a shorter time frame but spin at a higher speed, such as 1500 centrifugal force. So your red blood cells will be prepped. You can make a 50% dilution of it in your RPMI media. This is the one that you haven't added serum to. And then you're going to go ahead and use it at a final hematocrit. It's referred to as hematocrit, or which is red blood cell volume, at of 5%. So the technical definition for hematocrit, if you didn't know, like I didn't know, is the proportion of blood that is occupied by red blood cells. So depending on your culture vessel, add enough blood to the culture vessel. So in this, we're using a 5 milliliter capacity flask, cell culture flask. So we're putting the required volume in that. And once we put the red blood cells, we're going to add our parasites to the red blood cells. So before you put it away, you want to degas or gas the system. And so you add gas to the system for 20 seconds, to the parasites for 20 seconds. Then you want to tightly close that. And we're going to put that into a 37 degree incubator. So with the parasites, you want to monitor their growth every 24 hours. To do this, you want to carefully aspirate the media. So with this, because it's a suspension cell line, the red blood cells will easily, they're floating, so they will easily mix with the media if you're not careful. So when you're handling them, you have to handle them very gently, place them very gently, tilt them very gently in order to be able to remove the media only, leaving the parasite and the red blood cells still settled at the base. The way you monitor the growth is to look at parasitemia, how much of the parasites are in the red blood cells. So it's a little bit different from other cell lines where you can just look at the flask under a microscope, a bit more work involved. So what you want to do is take a few microliters of the parasites once you've removed the media. You don't want any media when you're doing these smears, because you're not going to be able to accurately quantify how much parasitemia, how much parasites you have inside your red blood cells. So a few microliters here, we're just dabbing a 5 mL serological pipette into the parasite culture, and whatever enters it is what we are dabbing onto the slide. Then you want to use another clean slide. All these slides are cleaned previously with 90% ethanol. You want to use another clean slide and just follow the motion where you bring all the pool of the blood into one line using the other glass, and then you want to swiftly drag quickly the blood to make a smear. And the smear should be in this, it's described as a tongue shaped smear. So anytime you need to change the media, this is what you will follow. You will tilt the culture flask, you remove the RPMI, the media, you remove the media, and then you go ahead and replace the media with fresh red blood cells in order to maintain the volume of red blood cells, maintain the hematocrit. So we have to quantify the parasites inside the red blood cells in order to see how the parasites are doing. And so here we're going to quantify the parasites. We're going to need the microscope. We're going to need methanol, and we are going to need GIMSA stain at 10%. Make it from a 100% stock so that it's at 10%. You dissolve the gimsa in phosphate buffered saline. So what you do is fix the slides for 4 to 5 seconds in the 100% methanol. Then you want to add your 10% gimsa that you've diluted in phosphate buffered saline and leave that on for 20 minutes. Then you want to gently rinse the gimsa off of the slides, and you are now going to allow it to air dry before it's ready for viewing under a light microscope. And I'm specifying light microscope because there are various types of microscopes. In this case, we're just using the first one that was ever invented, which just uses light, a light source to illuminate the specimen. You want to start on the 4X objective so that you will be able to locate where the red blood cells are on the slide. Once you've got that in place, you can move on to the 100X objective, which is the oil immersion. So, and then we rotate the wheel so that we have the 100X objective. And now we are able to use only the fine focus in order to be able to visualize the red blood cells and hopefully identify the parasites inside the red blood cells. Can you spot the parasites inside the red blood cells? So here you're looking for particular shapes and you're looking for the purple staining of the gimsa. So there are different forms that the parasites may be at different stages of development. If you're not familiar, I have covered the stages of development of the parasite on this channel. So I will also link that in the comments. You can take a look. So here's a chart of what you're looking for, and there's some descriptions that are used. So the ring stage, as you can see, looks a bit like a ring. Then there is a stage, I've actually heard someone describe it as the head forming stage as well. So the head forming stage is typically the trophozoid stage, but there are variations in that structure as well. And then there are also, so the first two rows in this image are your ring stage, then the third and fourth are your trophozoid manifestations or morphology. The fifth row is showing you the schizon morphology. Then the final row is showing you the gametocytes. You don't expect to see too many gametocytes in a parasite smear if the cells are healthy and happy. So then we can determine how much parasites we've got inside our red blood cells. So first we have to count all the red blood cells that are in view. Then we go ahead and factor in how many of them had parasites in them. And you can actually separate the parasites based on whether it was a ring, it was a trophozoid or a schizon stage. And then you go ahead and total all the stages and divide it by your total number of red blood cells to get your percent. Well, if you multiply by 100, then you'll get your percent parasitemia after dividing your parasites versus your total red blood cell population. Special thanks to Yakubu Osmanu from Noguchi Memorial Institute of Medical Research for the expert walkthrough of how to do this culturing and the calculation of the parasitemia. I'll see you in the next video. God bless. Bye.